Welcome to Blank Spot Project. We are organizing this seminar today together with civil rights defenders. If you don't have a seat, please put your jacket outside to the left and then find a seat. It's possible to sit in the windows as well. We will start in a few minutes, and this seminar will be recorded on the internet. You will find it on the Blank Spot webpage, and you can also listen to it afterwards. Okay, are we ready? Yeah? Okay. So I would very much like to welcome Mesfin Negash, who is going to moderate this seminar, and you will lead us from here. Okay, thank you. Welcome.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome again. On behalf of civil rights defenders, I would like to thank you and welcome again to this seminar. And I would also like to thank Tesfalem for availing himself to have this seminar in Stockholm. He had to travel from Germany and Paris to be with us today. So thank you. My name is Mesfin Negash, for those of you me. I'm working for civil rights defenders. In a way, it is personal for me to introduce Tesfalem because I have never imagined myself to introduce this guy formally in any setting. But it is very unfortunate now that I should introduce him formally. Tesfalem is a well-known journalist and much more respected for his insistence in professional journalism. He is very known among Ethiopian journalists, and journalists particularly interested in Ethiopia, foreign correspondents based in Ethiopia. He has been working with quite a number of international renowned media outlets such as BBC, AP, the United Nations, IRIN, and Expressen from Sweden, and ATC, and others. So he knows the nitty-gritty of the Ethiopian politics from a journalistic perspective, of course. He always insists that. He might offend some of you for that, but we'll see in the discussion. Apart from his professional history, he was also imprisoned for 1 month and 1 year and 3 months, among other two journalists and six bloggers, the Zone 9 bloggers. He was accused, but later on just released without any explanation, to say so. We'll get into that detail later on. So let me start from the latest. What happened yesterday while we were having a dinner with two Swedish friends? Somebody called him, anyways.
Yeah, somebody called me, and I just learned that one of my prison friend, one of the bloggers who were kept with me for a year, I just found out that he rearrested again the day before yesterday, and it was in the middle of a dinner with friends. I just learned this, and it was really personal, it was really touchy. I can't even continue the discussion in the that guy, Natnael Feleka, we spent a year together in prison, and he's one of the principled and very, I don't know, it's very difficult to explain. Natnael is he continue blogging, and he's continued to talk about the human rights abuses in Ethiopia, what he have seen in prison, even after he has released, and we always talk about that, you know, his personal safety is in danger, but he continued talking about that, and even the latest one, what happened on Sunday in Ethiopia, there was a very big accident. So many people were killed in a Thanksgiving celebration, and he was personally strongly criticized the way the government handled that security thing, and the police fire, you know, tear gas, and all they also fired on the protesters who were attending that Thanksgiving celebration. And he was critically saying something about that on his Twitter and on his Facebook, and we just found out that he was discussing about this incident with his two colleagues. He is a banker, so while he was discussing in a cafe, in an open cafe, some plainclothes security personnel, they just came in, they arrested him. While I was talking now, he's in a police station. He might appear in the Ethiopian court to get some bail. Whether he will get bail or not, that's a very big another thing, but he will, I think he will appear today at the court, and I don't know, it's very difficult to talk about this. It's really touchy.
In a way, it is similar with how you were arrested and later on released, isn't it? How did it happen?
It is the same thing. When I was arrested, I was also arrested from a cafe while I had a magazine while on my hand. I was alone. They just two security, plainclothes security personnel, they just came and they approached me and they asked me that you are wanted for investigation, and I was really surprised. And how come you just communicated with me just like that? So can you show me some identification card or something like that? And while we were arguing like this, a policeman who wear a federal police uniform, he just came and he told me that, and he showed me his ID, and I was taken to my house. There was a house search, and they confiscated almost all materials in my house, even the novels, even the books and the CDs, the opera CDs I have from Poland. Even took that one because they think that it is some terrorist material, something like that. And newspapers, Time magazine, all those things, because those people who are searching my house, they don't know which material is needed by the investigators. So they took almost everything from my house. And whenever someone calls them, they said that this is a journalist's house, you know, it's full of papers and full of documents. How can we finalize our searching within 1 hour or 2 hours? Give us some time. So it took them at least 4 hours, and there were around eight policemen and security guys in my house. So from cafe to my house, from my house to the amazing, the infamous prison in Ethiopia, it's called Maakalawi. I was taken there and I stayed there for 3 months. One of the toughest, the worst moment of my life, staying in Maakalawi. Those of
what
you...
What was the investigation about? Did they have anything in their hands, or they were just looking for something which they don't know?
They don't have anything on their hand. They just asked us a lot of questions, because personally, my investigation, they were asking about why I received trainings outside of my country, journalism trainings, what is my relationship with foreign people, like foreign agents, that's what they call them. So for example, I had a very good communication with organizations like CPJ, Committee to Protect Journalists. So they don't like such communication with such big organizations, such human rights organizations, or journalism rights defending organizations. And they were also asking about our activities on social media. because they believe that we had a mission to destabilize the upcoming Ethiopian election. It was at that time, a year before the election, when we were arrested. So they thought that we had a mission to disrupt that election. But they did not have anything on their hand. They have all our materials, all books and everything, but when they asked us our questions, it was not about finding the truth. Mm-hmm. It was about framing us on something they just already in their mind. Mm-hmm. So they are pushing us to that, that place.
Were you arrested because they assume you are a member of the Zone 9 bloggers? Or
yes. Yes.
They didn't even know that whether you are a member or not. Or
To tell you the truth, later during the investigation, they did not directly told me about, you know, they differentiate. I'm not a Zone 9 blogger, but I don't know. I don't understand. I don't have a clear picture about this, but sometimes they are trying to force me to confess that I am a Zone 9 blogger. I told them that all my Zone 9 bloggers are my close friends. I know them personally. I really support their activity. That's what I told them. But the big problem is that sometimes they say it is that for other friends of mine during interrogation, they told them that, yeah, we know who Zone 9 bloggers are and who journalists are. But when they come to me, they always ask me, what is your contribution in Zone 9 blog? Mm-hmm. And I told them that, did you see my name in that blog? Mm-hmm. We didn't hide anything. My friends didn't hide anything. All their names and all their bylines, everything is there. Mm-hmm. So the things also what they wrote on Zone 9 blog, it's not hiding from anyone. It's just open. The blog is there. The Facebook is there. The Twitter account is there. So everyone can know this thing. So the argument with our interrogators is that they are trying to find something behind. And we told them the truth again and again, and they have everything on their hand. Our laptops were there, my camera was there, my recorder was there, my notebooks were there. Everything is on their hand, and they couldn't find anything.
Were you and your mates tortured in any way? How was the treatment at Maakalawi? This is a central investigation office. That's the Amharic word for that.
I don't know whether, I don't know, people read the Martin Shibier and Johan Persson's book. For
you two have, of course, you'll exchange notes about the prison later, but yeah.
Yes, Maakala is like, it's the place we kept, we called it Siberia, because we compared it with Siberia. It's a very cold place, and it was like we are only allowed 10 minutes to have a sunlight. We are kept 24 hours locked in a very very small room crowded with all political prisoners, and we were sleeping on the floor, and we are only allowed twice a day to go to the toilet, just only for 10 minutes. If you have any other problem in the daytime, they will tell you that you can die. We don't care. We don't have any problem with you. So they don't care about us. Mm-hmm. So only 10 minutes allowed to go out. And sometimes if the outside is cloudy, when we were arrested, it was near to the rainy season. So most of the time it's rain. So sometimes we don't see the outside for 2 days or something like that. Mm-hmm. But that's only for 10 minutes. So I didn't know that the blue sky is very much attached to my life. I didn't feel that I will miss a sky. And whenever we are out for 10 minutes, I was staring on sky for 10 minutes and it's just over and I go back, because we didn't have the chance to see that. So we are only allowed to have a shower once per week. So it's a very congested area. People came from different locations from Ethiopia. So the hygienic situation is, you can guess, I was really sick most of the time. It's really cold also. and because of that I was really fragile at that time. The food is not the food is provided by the government or the prison administration is very terrible, so we are totally depend on the food that comes from our family. About the torture, I personally didn't face any beaten
physically.
I was not beaten, but the things are I explained to you, it's already torture for me. But on my own eyes, I have seen people, the beaten people, those inmates who are kept with me, all of them are political prisoners, or all of them are suspects of terrorism, and all of them are decent. I mean, some of them are opposition party members, some of them are students who are participated in demonstrations. Most of them, they are taken to interrogation and they are beaten. They are abused, physically abused. Some of the Zone 9 bloggers also, we always exchange information while we are taken to a toilet. That 10 minutes we also use as a way of exchanging information. It's not allowed to exchanging information. So when one room is out for toilet time, so we are kept in different cells, so we are trying to exchange information. And my blogger friends, they are always telling me that they are facing this problem. They are beaten, and the way they were treated. You know, some of the interrogations are happened after midnight or near to midnight in the evening. So it was terrible. I didn't even call it interrogation, to tell you the truth. I mean, I haven't seen any professional way of doing. The one I have seen on TV or on the Western type of interrogation was not there. It was really terrible. And the other thing I shall tell you is that, do you know the computer cable? So they kept that computer cable in the interrogation room in their offices. That means I was not personally beaten, but people are beaten by that one. And okay. Some of my blogger friends are beaten by that one.
So yeah, the bloggers, they are tortured. One of them has a sustained pain in his ear. Yeah. He has a problem now.
His name is Abel. Mm-hmm. Abel he can't listen properly now. Mm-hmm. And he was using a hearing aid for after that. He was really, really,
Two of the women bloggers were forced to be naked in front of their investigators. Yeah. That was one way of torturing them.
Yeah, not only naked, but they do physical exercise. They told them that, you know, to push the wall. And they told them that, you know, pushing the wall, this wall, EPRDF is just like that. You can't push the wall and you can't, you know, move that wall. So they are trying to do nasty things about that. Mm-hmm. In fact, from other prisoners, we heard so many human rights abuses. Mm-hmm. I heard personally there was a rape. It was not happened on us. That does not mean that there is no human right abuse or like that. Mm-hmm. There was a woman I have seen on my own eyes. That woman, she's from Somali region. And she shared that information with our women bloggers, mm-hmm. as well as others. There was a rape. Mm-hmm. And the Muslim committee members, mm-hmm. who were also arrested along with us, they told us so many horrible incidents. They were hanging like this, their hands and their mm-hmm. things, and they were tortured in so many ways. Mm-hmm. And they stayed like that for a day or two. Mm-hmm. And they put, anyways, so many horrible things. A bottled water, full of water, they just put that, the genital of the main prisoners. Mm. That's how horrible the way during the interrogation.
Mm. Well, I think your ordeal in prison might have a lot of details, and I hope you'll write something in the future. But as much your arrest was dramatic, your release was also so dramatic.
Yeah,
when did you know that you're going to be released and on what condition?
It was, I was informed just minutes before my release.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't know that. In fact, my name was called on a megaphone. We have this PA system in the prison because whenever our friends and our family came, so our name was called mm-hmm. by that PA system. So my name was called again and again, and it was like in afternoon, it's near to the end of the working hour, and I thought that they are mistaken. I mean, how come they will call my name, because our court process is ongoing and we have an appointment in after 2 weeks or something like that, and we are not sentenced yet. So I didn't expect my name will be called like that. And I told my friend, I was with the other blogger, we were watching Freedom Writers, a movie called Freedom Writers, and it was broadcasted on the state, the national television. So I was glued on that movie, because it was really touchy. You are in prison and you are watching Freedom Writers, and it's a Hilary Swank movie. And I know that movie, but from the prison perspective, it's really touchy. And I told them that, please don't disturb me, and let me watch it. And he told me that, your name is called on the PA system. And I told him that they are just mistaken, you know, they are confusing. So later, another blogger, our friend, Bafikadu, he was in the library. So he came and he said that, your name is repetitively called. Why you are still here? This thing seems serious. So I went out with the two of them. We are three in one zone. So when we go to the guy who was calling our names, and he showed us the lists. And on that list, I have seen the name of Zalalem and Asmamaw, the two other
journalists.
One journalist, one blogger from different zones. So we were really surprised, because only that three names are there, and the two of my blogger friends, their names was not included in that one. So I don't understand. I don't realize what's really happening.
Because all of you were charged in one file for the same crime.
It is the same crime, the same evidence brought against us. No evidence at all, except the training materials we collected from different places. I mean, from different trainings. So I was really surprised, and I felt it like that. You know, it's just
a mistake.
So we were standing, and there was this policeman who was furious and who was trying to search me in the compound. And he came to me, where is this Tesfalem guy? Why he's refused to be released? And I told him that, I don't understand what is really going on. My friends are here. Their name is not included. And my name is only appeared on that one. Your friends from another zone, they are already released. And you are the only one who are refused to be released. And I was really arguing with them. So if I am released, how come they are not released? If I am released, what is the reason? What is the reason, the ground? And at this time, when during our discussion, many inmates are circling us, and they just enjoy the discussion, and they don't understand why I'm refusing to leave that prison. You know, if they have got this chance, they will run away. But I don't understand, because my friends are still there. They are still confused. I'm really confused. So the main guy, the prison administrator, came with my file.
Okay.
So there was a picture of mine. You know, they took your picture, they put your data and everything. So he called me and he asked me, your name is Tesfalem. Your mother's name is like this. You're born in this time. So you are arrested. All the details. And after that, come with your things and leave this place. You should leave it now, he said. So I was, surprised. I have my sandals and my pajama. I mean, because in prison, we didn't wear a proper clothes. So I just go and I just pick one bag and I just follow the main guy. And that main guy, he said, is that he gave me one paper. It's a very like a receipt type, and they just put my name and everything. And they mentioned is that why I'm released. When I asked why I'm released, and they told me that the prosecutor dropped the charge. What about the others? I don't know anything about this. Just get this receipt and get out of the prison. That's what they told me. Mm-hmm. I was really shocked, and I went outside of the prison, and at that time the working hour is over. There is no car.
It was late afternoon.
It's late afternoon, and there was no car. There is nothing. The prison is located outskirts of Addis Ababa, so it's not like accessible by everyone. So I went out outside, and I was just put my bag, and I was confused where to go. Mm. I don't have money. I kept some money, but I don't know what to do. So I just have seen a tuk-tuk, three-wheel drive car there. And I went to the driver and asked him, can you please borrow a phone to me because I wanted to call to my family. I just released. And the guy gave it to me, his phone, and I called my friends and I told them that I'm released. They don't believe it. So I called my sister and I told her that I'm released. And she said that, how come? It's really surprising because this is a very high profile case and our name is appeared every time. Anyway, it's really confusing, and we just released like that. And we found out later that it was because Obama supposed to visit our country, and we were released 2 weeks before his visit to Ethiopia.
Yeah. I mean, in a way, Tesfalem and the Zone 9 bloggers and quite few of the political prisoners in Ethiopia are very lucky because we know them. The world had heard about them. But I very much doubt if they represent 0.1% of the political prisoners in Ethiopia. So that really shows how the situation is very gruesome there. I really don't want to keep you reminding that story. Unfortunately, I'm not taking you to a better land, but how is the situation now in Ethiopia? A lot has been said, a lot has been written in the last few weeks and months. I don't know how many of you know, there is an ongoing political crisis in Ethiopia. What's going on in Ethiopia as a journalist?
Not as a journalist, but as a citizen. The situation in Ethiopia now is very terrible. The country is in a crossroads. The day I left the country 2 months ago, there was a wide protest in the country, like in Oromia, the largest ethnic group, and in Addis Ababa, there was a demonstration. I was covering that demonstration. In the evening, I supposed to catch a plane to come to Germany, but I was covering a demonstration. I have seen on my own eyes hundreds of young Oromos who were trying to demonstrate in Addis Ababa were arrested. A machine gun was out on the street in Maskal Square. Maskal Square is the main square in Addis Ababa, and people are trying to demonstrate on that one. And for the first time, I think after a long time, this thing is a process. The protest is started last October, so it's almost a year now. But for the first time, the international media has got a chance to record the police brutality at Maskal Square, and I was there, and I have seen so many people are arrested. And I thought that I will not be allowed even to travel outside of the country, because previous to that, six months ago, when I was trying to travel to Germany, my passport was confiscated. So now they gave me my passport back, and I thought that was the day, according to Amnesty International, 100 demonstrators were killed. Before that, according to Human Rights Watch, around 500 people killed. That was like the report was come out like May or something
April,
like that.
April or May.
April or May. And after that, the killing is really continued. Every day, if you open our Facebook page, you see very tragic pictures. Youngsters are died, and now, thanks for the technology, nothing is hiding. Everything is out. Thanks for the mobile revolution in Africa, Ethiopia is one of the beneficiaries of that one. People are really becoming a citizen journalist, and they recorded almost everything. There is a video evidence and there is a picture evidence, and the identity of those people who are killed on the streets are out minutes by minutes. And almost every day people are killed in Ethiopia, and hundreds of people, I can say thousands of people, are arrested since the protests started last October. So it is it started like there was a Addis Ababa master plan, the expansion of, you know, integrating Addis Ababa with the capital city, with the surrounding area. And farmers are,
evicted.
Evicted from their lands, and they did not get enough compensation. And it's because of that they started demonstrating because of that. But now it becomes an anti-government protest. It started from Oromia, the largest ethnic group, but now it moved to Amhara, that is the second largest ethnic group in Ethiopia. So the two largest ethnic groups is accounted like almost two-thirds of the country. So the country is not only the two tribes, or it's also in the southern part there is a problem. In the western part, in Gambela, there is also a problem. In Somali region, where Martin Shibie and Johan Persson arrested, that area is
a no-go area.
It's no-go area. No one is allowed to go that area. Journalists are, even now, they are not allowed to go that area. So the country is in turmoil now, and the incidents, what's happening is a very fast-moving things, even for us, even for journalists. We are following minutes by minutes update from our country. It's very difficult to grasp, let alone for outsiders.
How is the government responding to this widespread protest? And
the government is always using forces to control these protests. It's a public uprising, and we have seen such type of uprising in other countries also. They should learn from such incidents. Instead of bringing a peaceful solution, they deployed military in these two regions. Now the military is take over the security apparatus in these two big regions, and now the military versus the people. So they come out with machine guns, they come out with their old military equipments, and they are trying to control, they are trying to suppress the people's protest. And they always said that this thing is supported by some foreign elements outside of the country. But it's a sporadic type of protest. Mm-hmm. When you are trying to shut down or when you are trying to control, suppress by military from this area, it happened just within hours difference in another place. So it's a really, really... it's very difficult situation.
What would you say if somebody asked you what are the most important grievances of the public, if you name two or three causes? Why people are protesting, really?
Let me give you a very good example. The last election, the ruling party won 100% seat. So in a country where the ruling party won 100% seat, it's expected that the people are supposed to be satisfied if that election is free and fair. I don't know in which country you have seen 100%. In even the most dictatorial countries, they just put it like 90-something percent. But now we are 100% in the last election. And the people...
And it's a country of 100 million, and the national parliament has 547 seats, and the regional states also have their own councils or local parliament. They are the total is more than 10,000 seats in the country. So the ruling party basically won all seats. It's so a unique ruling party anyways.
Yeah, and their supporters, I mean, their members are like 3 million or something like that. In a country with a ruling party won 100%, 3 million supporters and everything, you expected that so many people are satisfied. But that is, it started from that one. Okay. Everything is shut down in that country. There is no freedom of expression. There is no freedom of the press. Political rights are not there. If you wanted to demonstrate in that country, you will be arrested. If you wanted to express your voice out just against what the government believes, it's really another thing in that country. So,
but how about economically? Reports about Ethiopia's economic rise, not even only growth, is so rosy a picture that every other African country wish to copy, and a lot of Western international partners would like to associate themselves with, and so on. How is that playing, the economic growth?
Yeah, there is a change in Ethiopia. In my opinion, I can't say that there's no change in Ethiopia. There are changes. There are roads built in Ethiopia. There are infrastructures are built everywhere. The government is in some ways, when it compared to other African countries, they deliver when it comes to some issues. Talking about quality and other things, that's another issue. But the Chinese contractors, they took over most of the contracts and they did deliver some of the services. Of course, schools are built, health stations are built, roads are built, and like that. But when it comes to the real life, the ordinary life, there is not that much change. So people are frustrated. 50% or 60% of the population is young, and the unemployment rate is very high. That's one grievance in Ethiopia. The education quality is really bad. The health quality, we are obsessing with numbers in Ethiopia. We are trying to multiply everything, but the quality is really bad. There is a little bit change in the economy, but when it comes to real growth or development, real development, we don't develop that much. Of course, there is change, I can say.
How is the civil society responding to this impending crisis in Ethiopia?
Is there any civil society in Ethiopia now? I mean, there are, since 2005 elections, the government come up with different legislatives, different laws. One is a very bad type of is the NGO law or the civic society, the CSO law, they called it. So because of that, they are successfully weakened the contribution of the civic society organization in that country. Most of the strong, even before in Ethiopia, we don't have that much very strong institutions, but after that election is passed, following to the 2005 election, almost all institutions are dead or weakened. So most influential foreign organizations, they left the country. Those who are now existing in the country, they didn't do almost anything. They existed in Addis Ababa with their office and everything, but their limitation, their capacity is very limited. Their human resource, manpower is very limited. They did not get a fund from outside because there is a restriction, 90 to 10%. If you get 90% from outside of the country, you are not allowed to do human rights advocacy and other rights issue. So the rights issue is one of the big things. So all these things are happened in Ethiopia, the human rights abuse, the arrest, and all that things are left untouched because all these organizations which are supposed to do the investigation and the report and everything, they are not allowed to do that because of the law.
I will throw only two questions and then I will open the floor for a few questions and comments. What's in store for Ethiopia? What do you see coming in the coming, let's say, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years? What's in store? What are the scenarios you see?
Ethiopia is a very difficult country to predict to tell you the truth, even for political analysis and even for those who followed the Ethiopian situation, who studied the Ethiopian situation for a long time, it's always very difficult to predict what will come next. But in my opinion, and what I have seen on the ground there, is I have seen the strengths of the military, and if things are going on this pace, the military might take over the civilian administration. They are already involved in some parts of Oromia and Amhara region. Now it's governed by, literally governed by the military, but it might happen in Ethiopia is that we will go back to the military regime.
Okay.
Before this regime comes, we were administered by the military regime. And in most African countries, as you have seen, when things are going a little bit tough, the military take over. Mm-hmm. So I have seen the military guys are criticizing the civilian administration. You are not doing very well, so let us give us some time to do such a thing. They openly said in some meetings like that. So I'm suspecting that one. Mm-hmm. The other thing, for foreigners, when I'm trying to discuss this thing, I always mention the Syrian situation. In Ethiopia, we have 85 ethnic groups. It's a very large country. It's a very diverse country, but there was a big tension in Ethiopia now. There is a big tension in Ethiopia now between some tribes. And if things are not controlled, if we didn't bring a peaceful solution for the political crisis in Ethiopia, the Syrian situation might happen, the civil war, or the Yugoslavia thing might happen in Ethiopia. I'm not wishing for my country a gloomy or a doomsday type of future, but I'm really scared for my own country. This thing might happen, because the government is successfully shut down all the institutions, all the elderly's role in Ethiopia. Previously, when we fall in crisis, the elderly's come, some institutions come, and you know, those scholars and like that, they come and mediate. In some ways, we have a way to go out. But now, for the last 25 years, this government is successfully wiped out all these means. And now, when people are asking that, is there anyone who can mediate between the protesters and the government? We can't even find people on the ground. So I don't see a bright future for my country. Mm-hmm. I'm really scared, and I'm really afraid for my country. Things leading to civil war and bad situation might happen.
Well, that is a very pessimistic take on Ethiopia. I remember one of the most renowned Ethiopian historians, Professor Baharu Zode, once said that Ethiopia is a country of miracles. I had a hard time to accept that. If Ethiopia survived what's going on now, probably I would take that thesis for the future. But we will see. Just to conclude, I'm sure somebody will ask you later on, so let me make it easier for you. What the international partners can do, like Sweden, who doubled its development cooperation just in March with a big fanfare here?
That's one of the top questions I always face while I'm traveling in Europe. People are asking me, what shall the international community can do? I think, development assistance, stopping development assistance is not a solution for Ethiopia, because so many people are relied on development assistance. Ethiopia is facing the worst drought in the last 15 years this year. And I have been on, I traveled with international media to a very remote areas where food distribution is going on, and most of the food that distributed for that country comes from abroad. The government even can't feed its own people. Of course, there is a big fanfare. We are in a very good economic development and like that, but we are still relying on the development assistance that comes from Europe, America, and the other donors. So if that development assistance is stopped, so many people will suffer. So I don't advise to stop the development assistance. But diplomatically, the Westerners can do something against the Ethiopian government. That's what I believe. They can do travel ban of the government officials who are in human rights abuses in Ethiopia. So many people are killed on the streets, and this is not hiding. This is recorded on video. This is recorded on pictures, and human rights organizations come up with big reports about these things. It's not a secret. So they should start punishing those officials by, like, a travel ban for their own and for their family. Because they are always coming here and they always brag about their successful achievements. The other thing is that the Westerners always use Ethiopia as an example for other African countries to copy their developmental path. They should stop doing that. They should stop inviting them in G7 and G20 and other meetings. It is just like a way of supporting, do some developments and do the human right abuse also. You should balance between. I don't advise to stop the developmental assistance. They should continue to do that because we are really greatly endowed with, we are really thank the donors to bring something for us because our people are survived because of that. But appreciating what the Ethiopian government is doing is really another thing. So they should send a clear message to the Ethiopian government. Look at it. I think after a few days, Angela Merkel will travel to Ethiopia. So that means for the government, it's just like giving a recognition. I didn't see the merit of going to Ethiopia at this bloody time. So they should stop recognizing the Ethiopian government. And they should do the travel ban and other diplomatic ways of handling this.
Well, that is provocative and inviting for quite a debate. There is someone here who was in Kaliti, so he cannot resist the temptation. Martin has few words to say.
No, I mean, first of all, congratulations for beating my 438 days with one day.
Yeah.
I spent 439 days.
Thank you.
No, jokes aside, it's terrible to hear that the situation is deteriorating, and it's sad that this hunting season on journalists that was declared in Ethiopia a long time ago is still ongoing and getting worse by the day and by the hour. It's saddening to hear, but I'm still so inspired by the work that you yourself and your colleagues do, and you really show that they can jail journalists, but they can never jail journalism. And during your time in jail, also other people took over your kind of voice when you lost your voice and carried it further, and there's such a young, brave generation in Ethiopia demanding democracy, press freedom, and so on. So there is hope also in that sense. It's just been great to have you here listening. Just one thought I have is, we have this really deteriorating crisis. We have hundreds of dead the last month, but still it's kind of a media blackout when it comes to news from Ethiopia. Of course, there is an extreme news situation with Aleppo and the Battle of Mosul and other things coming up, but still I feel that there is a lack of coverage. And of course, the reason is that the people who could do that job are locked in or are afraid to speak. But that puts an even greater responsibility on foreign reporters and foreign journalists to be there and to cooperate with local journalists and give people a voice and also be there to check what's happening now that the situation is getting worse. And one of the I mean, project that we as, I mean, I'm editor-in-chief at Blank Spot Project, and one of the ideas we have for the future is really to launch an investigation into Ethiopia. So the money we get from new members the coming month, we will use it to make journalism possible from Ethiopia. So that's one way to do it. Sure. But I think that the stage belongs to you and all the honor, so you should have the questions, and I can pass on the mic for people who want to ask questions.
Sure. Thank you for that. thank you for that good initiative from Blank Spot Project. And obviously, the need is there, definitely. We will have a few minutes, so I see Ahmed there, and yeah, sorry, I don't know your name.
Yeah. First and foremost, me?
No. Oh. No. Should I? No.
Okay. First and foremost, and I want to say welcome and congratulations for being free. Now I'm a bit confused when you told us about the development aid. You said so many millions of Ethiopians are in need of the help from the West. Can you be specific? Should this help be given to the government or to non-governmental organizations? As long as the government gets the money it needs, why should it bother the reaction of the West? They are not interested. I mean, it's not big deal for them to be invited to Europe as long as they have the power in Ethiopia to control everything. Wouldn't it be wise to give the money, the aid, to non-governmental organizations that can give the money to the people directly? As long as the information I receive, or so many of us receive, the government and use the money to suppress the people. So I want you to be specific on this part. Or it reminds me of the situation in South Africa before their independence, when the two one another, those who wanted to make economic boycott and those who didn't. The reason those who said they don't want to make economic boycott was that it's the people who suffered. So please, I want you to be specific on this part.
Let's have two, three questions, and then he will reflect. Yes.
My name is Olof Björnsson. I work at Swedwatch. I have a question of a practical nature. I think many foreign journalists and civil society organizations need local partners in Ethiopia in order to work. But a lot of this work is held back by the fact that of a worry to endanger these local partners once the work is over and the foreign organizations go home. And I want to know your thoughts on this, how to balance the need for work, the need for reporting against the security and safety of the partners in Ethiopia. Okay. Thank you.
And yeah, you too.
I wondered if my name is John Ewing. I wonder if you could tell me a little bit about the role of the of neighboring countries in the area. You talked a little bit about travel bans for top officials, and I kind of wondered how would a travel ban actually work when you have Ethiopian security that's apparently able to operate pretty freely in neighboring countries, pick people up, etc. How would that practically work? Do you have any thoughts on that? Mm-hmm.
Okay. Sure.
Yeah. To answer some of the question in my own capacity, the development assistance, the NGOs, that was the question. Which NGOs are now operating in Ethiopia, and you know, those humanitarian organizations which allowed to operate, even to distribute food in Ethiopia is under strict control of the Ethiopian government. And there was, I remember after the 2005 election, there is the European government, they stopped giving direct budgetary support to the Ethiopian government, and rather than they are tunneling the money directly to the people using the lowest level of administration, like the Warada administration. But what really happens is that the Ethiopian government welcomed that because they know that the Warada is totally controlled by their own people. So whether you give it to the federal government or whether you give it to the local administration, this is not happening like the one we have seen in other countries. So it is the same thing. When it comes to the NGOs, of course, what the Western governments, what they are trying to do is the food distribution and other things, the developmental assistance is really managed by some organizations on the ground, like Christians, Catholic Relief Service, or like Save the Children, or like these organizations, UNICEF and others. So what I'm trying to talk about is these organizations. They received the money through that way. Of course, these Western governments, they pledge their aid totally for the country, but it comes through UNICEF, it comes through WHO and others. So the people is really desperate to get some support from outside. I have seen on the ground, people doesn't have anything to eat. If one or two rainy season failed in that country, million people need food aid. That's how the Ethiopian agricultural development is failed in that country. No one admits this. I mean, the Ethiopian government doesn't want to admit this, but within two consecutive rainy seasons failed, millions need food aid. So still, I'm talking about through these big organizations, many should be allocated through that one. So to be specific, that is the question. So the in danger of the security of the workers on the ground, or like journalists and human rights activists and others, yeah, it's happening. We are a living example for that one, because the Zone 9 bloggers, they are really working with some international organizations by, you know, supporting some of the things, doing reports and exposing the human rights abuses in that country. It is a very difficult one to answer this, you know, because I remember some people who were in Gambella, they were trying to help. So even the World Bank translating this grabbing problem, they are now in prison. There are so many examples like that. The only thing is the Westerners or the Western organization, they should be very careful when they communicate with these people. It's some people are naive enough to call directly to these people. And the phones are tapped in that country. If you are a suspect from the government, your phone will be tapped. Your email and others can be accessed, because in Ethiopia there is only one telecom provider which is owned by the state. So it's very easy to do surveillance against you. In some ways, it looks like East Germany. Yeah, it reminds me some of the things. And China, we use the technique of China to control dissents and human rights organizations and activists in that country. So I don't know exactly how to answer this question, because I know that after some communication, after some real works, the life of some activists and some people are in danger. So there should be an innovative way of communicating and working together with these people.
But do you and, think and, all doors one are
thing,
closed?
Yeah, one thing I should add is that there are people who are working outside of their country. Most of the time, people are thinking only the one who is inside. The one who went outside, they are forced to exile. They can't do so many things. They have their own links. They have family links, they have friendship links and everything. You can go through them and do something. And I've seen big organizations like other countries Ethiopians, we don't have that much big institutions and organizations based outside of their country. So I think the focus should be a little bit moved from the country to outside. And those Ethiopians and those people who are in safe place, they can manage to do something inside.
And the third question?
The third question is about the neighboring, what is the travel ban? The travel ban is a symbolic. The Ethiopian government needs this international recognition. Now, for the people, for its own citizenship, what it tells every time, even on state media, is that they are number one in the world. They have got recognition from this one and that one. So we know that, you know, in Ethiopia, the people, the public, and the government, we know each other. So they are always bring someone to do to make to give them some certification. When they told us that we are food secure, we know that food sufficient. We know that we are not food sufficient. But they brought, what was that in Rome? The United Nations Organization?
FAO.
They brought FAO and they said that, you see, we have got a certification from FAO. So when they are talking about health thing, they brought the United Nations, UNICEF, to get that certification. So they are always brought someone from outside to show us that, you know, we are on the right track. We are not the one who will tell you. The foreigners are the one who's telling you this. We are invited on G7, G20 because we are successful. That's how the narration in Ethiopia, that's how every day if you open the state media, that's how they are using it. When you are when there is a travel ban and the other things, these guys, they lost one propaganda means to tell the world. I know that, yeah, the security officials, they go to Kenya and they kidnap people and they brought it to Ethiopia without any questions. That's why so many journalists and human rights activists, after they exiled in Nairobi, they are afraid for their life. It's true. There are reports, even that the Kenyan newspapers are reporting about that. Ethiopian security officials, it's very easy for them to take someone from South Sudan or from Nairobi. We know that. But what I'm saying is that symbolic measures should be taken. That's it.
Yeah, as I said earlier, it invites a lot of questions. The issue of development aid and what kind of restraining measures international partners can do is not such an easy question, to be honest. So I can imagine many of you have additional comments and questions on that. Any additional question? Yes, let me start from here.
Yes, my name is Flaminia, and a comment on that. Last year I was working on Eritrea, and when looking at the international response to the problems of Eritrea, what we did see is that the main worry of the international community is actually stability in the region, and they don't really care about how stability is achieved. They don't want another Syria in that part of Africa. They already have huge issue of Somalia. Mm. And therefore, any government that actually promises stability or implements stability towards the outside world is to be supported. And I think that is one of the biggest problems here. And you have to take that into consideration when you are thinking how to sway the opinion of the international community vis-a-vis country like Ethiopia and Eritrea.
Mm. Yeah, that is the unfortunate reality when it comes to international partnership. Whether we like it or not, that's how at least the establishments in the West thinks: stability first at all costs. So it's our burden to find out the right formula, the right approach to change this. This is not really an easy question. You.
Oh, thank you. First, I want to thank you, Tesfalem, and your friends, and everyone in prison, and everyone who's dying. you've all been an inspiration to us. So I really want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. One question I have is, you were mentioning about the international community, the West, the government. I don't know if I have any hope in that. Let's face it, they don't really care about us. I mean, government. So maybe we can talk about the civil society organization, what they can do for us. But as she said already, they only care about the stability of the country, not actually about the people. The people are, we know what's happening to the people. So my question now maybe would be, what would the diaspora do, like as an organized, an organized group, because the diaspora, as we know, is somehow divided. So what, I don't know if you can even answer that, but what do you think? Do you think there's any hope in organizing the diaspora to do something tangible? What can we do individually, those who are in the diaspora? Thank you.
Okay. Any more questions? Yes.
Thank you. My name is Wanderson. I would like to add on some issues that the Western, so to say, the Western community or the international community keep on supporting the region for the reason of stability. But I think it's up to us, people like Tesfalem or those of us who are in the Western society now, to show that Ethiopia is not really stable. And the upcoming scenarios that we are seeing is it's a country governed with 6% of minority, and we have a similarity with the situation in Syria in 2011. So if things goes in this way with this pace, then it is true that we have a gloomy picture. So how can we show for the world that there is no stability, and there has never been stability if we look back few years down the line? And the other thing is, like, regarding development, I think this is my personal view, the Western government should stop giving aid to Ethiopia. In reality, they will not stop, but there is always be emergency aid. But the development, or there is always this money that goes to the government, injected directly to the budget. And this money, because I work on corruption, and I have a lot of information, but this money that goes directly to the government budget is usually ends up in the ruling elites. So it's up to us, like, to show and explain to that. And I want Tesfalem, if you could shed some light on this thing. And thank you.
Okay. One last question for the man at the last row.
I'm Tamro. I've been here for more than 6 months. My question is about what diaspora can do, but I want to elaborate some more. I want to put some comparative approach compared to, you know, the anti-apartheid struggle. I think the Ethiopian diaspora should have a realistic goal first. But having ban aid, banning flight ban, that are not red goals, according to me. If you see that the anti-apartheid struggle in South Africa, before the 1980s, the Western government used to work with the apartheid government closely. Western companies used to work closely with the apartheid government. But after that, by the leadership of Oliver Tambo, Thabo Mbeki, they used to organize universities all around Western countries. They used to spread news about the apartheid massacres, killings, of what happening in South Africa through the universities and through the civil societies in the Western country. So the mood of the society in the Western country changed, then the government position changed. I think the diaspora first should do this. The mood of the Western society should be well informed about what is happening in Ethiopia through the universities, through the civil societies. Then the governments might change their position. But jumping to other diplomatic tactics like trying to ban aid to Ethiopia, I think it's realistic for me. I think what I want to say that, and I hope you can reflect on it.
Thank you. I don't know which of the questions.
I can say something.
Yeah, please, in any order you like.
The stability issue. We know that. We live in Africa, and I traveled extensively in the Horn of Africa, and I know the situation there. Horn of Africa is one of the very volatile regions in the world. From pirates up to Al-Shabaab and all those problems. Yeah, there is real danger in that area. We understand, I personally understand the Western's concern when it comes to security in that area. Look at Somalia is a failed state and they are trying to form a government there. Eritrea is Eritrea, as you know. So South Sudan is a newborn country. It's in civil war. Kenya, of course, it's a stable country, but Kenya is always affected by Al-Shabaab and others. Ethiopia is a little bit, Djibouti is a camp for the foreigners, the French and the Americans. But I know that's a very dangerous and volatile region, and there is a security concern when it comes to that. And Ethiopia is playing a very crucial role stabilizing that area. It's true. But now the country who is trying to stabilize other countries becoming unstable. So it becomes a self-defeating thing for the foreigners now. They always said that Ethiopia is a very big country. There is a state for the last thousands of years state. The country is staying as a state for a long time. I understand that one. But if the country is descending to a civil war, it will be a total blow for the security in the Horn of Africa and even for Africa. Addis Ababa is the capital city of Africa Union. And the capital city of Africa, that's what they said, and it's the seat of the African Union, and they are playing a very crucial role. So the Westerners should be doing much better when it comes to stabilizing that country. They should start pushing the government to bring a long-lasting solution and a peaceful solution. I don't know, in any means, they should bring that stability back to that country. Otherwise, things will be nasty in that area, and the things which they are mostly concerned, the security issue, will be out of their hand so soon, because the government will be very busy of handling its own citizens rather than going to Somalia and controlling that. Look at it. In the current discussion about South Sudan, Ethiopia is almost not playing a very big role. The Uganda and the others are playing a big role now. Previously, our prime ministers are the one who played a very key role. Now we are busy of our things. So the security issue is there, but another thing. The diaspora, the one she mentioned. Ethiopian diaspora, they did a lot. I respect that. They always come out to demonstrate when we were arrested. You guys are the one, and all the people outside, they brought our pictures and everything, and they are trying to shed the light, the policymakers in this country and in other places. But as you said, the Ethiopian diaspora is fragmented, and we are very weak when it comes to unified position. And we don't have institutions. Ethiopians, we always want to run just like our runners alone, rather than staying and having its own institutions. What we lack in our country because of our government, we can't do it in this country. We can't do it in Western countries. That's what I believe.
if we don't have a human rights organization in Ethiopia, why don't we open it here? Why don't we have projects like Blank Spot Project or something like that? Are we Ethiopians are not capable of doing this outside of our country? Do we have problems? Here, everything is here. Internet is not accessible in Ethiopia. Internet is here. I mean, we can't do so many things. Now everything is, I mean, information is accessible in a very easy way, and we can do so many things when it comes to activism and things related like that. And one thing after I came here, what I found out that there are some Ethiopians who are citizens of that country, and they did not even participate in the local politics. They just only think about their own country, and instead of being a member of the political parties, or instead of being involved, like, you know, there are parliamentarians who are representing them. So they can approach them and they can sell the Ethiopian situation to this member of parliamentarians, and this member of parliamentarians can bring it to the Swedish parliament or the German parliament and other places. You know, there are so many issues in this world. The Syrian issue is very big. The immigration issue is becoming one of the big issues. So Ethiopians should do lots of things in to get attention from the politicians and the policymakers from the Western governments. That's what I believe. And we lack coordination, we lack unity, and we lack institutions. So we shall do, we shall change the system, the tactic, what we previously use. Demonstrations is not the only solution. We can learn from other communities, from other countries. They are very successful in so many ways.
Thank you. As I said earlier, I'm sure you have a lot of questions, but we are not here to exhaust and come up with a resolution. So thank you for joining the provocation, and let's keep the discussion. Thank you for coming, and let's keep in touch, and have a nice day. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Mesfin. Thank you, Tesfalem. And thank you all for coming to the Blank Spot Projects office. And on your way out, please take a copy of our magazine. But also, Keith from Civil Rights Defenders would like to conclude. No, you're satisfied. Okay. And this is an ongoing, this is an ongoing discussion. I think we need more journalism about Ethiopia. And please spread this, seminar that's now on. It's been live on Blank Spot Project's Facebook, and it will be on other pages as well. Please spread the word and keep the discussion ongoing about the situation in Ethiopia. So we give them a voice, and I see journalism has a great role to play in this future process. Thank you all. Thank you.